absolutely be in the top five. And I'm not just making that up, you guys, just the people here, the organization, the staff that run it, you're so wonderful and enthusiastic. And you know, the only downside is that there are like five conventions on Easter, on this weekend, somewhere. There's one in Houston this weekend, Anime Mount Surrey. There's MTAC in Nashville. There's Anime Kanji in San Diego. Anime Boston, I think. And then there's another one, I think, in Canada. But what is it? Is there another fan expo this weekend up there? Because I know there's one in the fall. Point is, you can't go to all of them. And I wanted to be here last year so bad, but I went to, where did I go last year? I don't care. It wasn't SakuraCon. That's what I remember. So I'm so glad you guys are here, and I'm so glad to be here back with you guys. I think many times the very first episode of anything is the one that, you know what I mean, kind of grabs you and sucks you in, and you're all like, oh my gosh, this is crazy. This guy's funny. Oh, this is really funny. Oh my gosh. You kind of learn about the characters. So I would say the first one, for sure, because there were a lot of wonderful scenes in the first one. The whole Commerce Coffee, and coming to the host club, and all of those fun things. And then I will also say that I really, really loved the episode with Kyoya when they first met.
Aww.
Right? Yes, the katsu table and stuff. Oh my gosh. Kyoya, my friend, Monami! And I loved that episode. Because you find out, and anime is so good. They're so good at this. They suck you in with comedy. They bring you in. They lure you in with hijinks and comedy. And once they've got you invested in the characters, they go, boom. And suddenly it's serious and heavy and dramatic and powerful. I love that. I love that. So some of my favorite, you know, my favorite thing about Tamaki is that when you find out, if you go far enough in the series, when you find out that his family, he has no relationship with his family, I believe he actually came right out and said, my grandmother hates me. So, and he says it very matter of fact, like he's just accepted it. Well, my grandmother hates me, so blah, blah, blah. And I remember recording it, I'm like, whoa, what? And then you start to see a picture forming. Tamaki created the host club, they have a family. Right? That's what it's all about. It's not about the flirtation. It's not even about the girls that come to visit the host club. It's about making himself a family of friends. Even the twins. Exactly. He refers to himself sometimes as daddy, and Goya is not right. I mean, it's his family. In fact, if you guys read the manga continues where the anime ended. And in the manga, how do he get accepted to college, I think at Harvard, and Tamaki refuses to let the host club be broken up, so he makes them all move to Harvard. That's beautiful. That's the thing, that's the kind of thing that I love the most about anime. If people didn't know better, they could think that you're kind of implying that you could have done a better job than the actors that did get cast, or that you're somehow putting down the people that did get cast. And I was like, that's not what I mean at all. That would never be what I meant. And they're like, yeah, well, if you come across that way, so stop doing it. When people would say that question, I would say, there are plenty of characters I would like to play, but I don't have a really good specific. I will tell you that there are some characters that I was playing that I loved. And then the studio that we were working for went out of business and they lost the license to those shows. How many of you know a show called Gurren Lagann? was being dubbed by a company in Houston, and I was playing Vero, and I was having a blast. And then the company went under, and they lost the license, and it went to some other company in California, and they cast it again from the beginning. How many of you know a show called Sergeant Frog? Guess what? Newsflash, I was Sergeant Frog before Matterhorn. I was Carol. And I love that show. Julian. I love that show so much. I was buying Carol toys at conventions, and we would put them on the shit on the mantle at the recording studio. We had 15 or 20 episodes recorded. And then the studio went out of business, and they lost the license. And it went to Funimation, and Funimation just decided to start over, wipe the slate clean, and start over. So there are a lot of characters that I'm going to play, but I will tell you something else. A lot of times, again, just like I told KJ, things just happen the way they're supposed to happen. I've auditioned for shows before where I really wanted to play a certain character, and I didn't get that character, and I was like, oh, boom. I got some other guy. And he turned out to be so much fun. More fun, probably, than I wanted to play. Perfect example, Full Metal Panic. I wanted to play Sosuke Sakura. He's the main character, right? Of course you want to play the main guy. I cast as him. I got cast as his other bozo, Kurtz Weber. And he turned out to be so fun! He was a great character. Much more like, flamboyant and just out there. And I loved him. I feel the same way about Deathsight from Soldier. I auditioned for several other characters, but I really love the guy I got. So I would never want any other actor to think that I was, diminishing the quality of what they were. Because I love all these guys, they're good friends. But great question. Thank you.
You look familiar.
Edges, the finishing, absolutely gorgeous. And I was also finding little pictures here and there that showed details that you didn't know were there. Like, for instance, there are these cubes around the back, around the pommel of Obi-Wan's lightsaber, the end piece. It's kind of dome-shaped, and there are little silver cubes around it. But what nobody knew was that those cubes have holes in them. And unless you were to see it from just the right angle, you wouldn't know. I saw this picture, and so I became like the preeminent Obi-Wan episode lightsaber guy on the replica props board. I even did a run of pieces, like detailed pieces, for other guys to buy so that they could make their own. That was like one of my most treasured, that is, I still have it. My most treasured piece that I had lost, that I do not have anymore, was a phaser. When I was, I know we're done here, but I know. Well, I lost some time at the beginning because everyone was late seating, so I'm stealing that time back. Sorry. When I was about 13 or 14 years old, I saw in a magazine, because there was no internet. Can you even conceive of that? I can't even conceive of it anymore. How did we ever buy stuff? How did we ever know that anything existed? But we did. And there was a magazine where they were selling this phaser for $75. Now, I gotta tell you, in 1976, that's a lot of money for a 13-year-old kid. Right, still is. But I saved it up, and I bought this phaser. It was the coolest thing ever. Batteries went up into the handle. It was made of metal. Batteries went up into the handle, and you could turn the dials on, and it would have this high pitch hum, and it was a strobe pistol. So when you pulled the trigger, it would, a strobe light flash. It was the coolest thing ever. I was so proud. So proud that I took it to school with me. Aww. How do you know where this story is going? I took it to school with me to show my friends, and they were all, of course, as you would imagine, thought it was the coolest thing ever. Well, then it was time to go to lunch, and I didn't want to take my beautiful phaser to lunch and take a chance on, it laying on the counter there, getting mashed potatoes on it or something. So I put it in a drawer in the men's dressing room of the theater where I did a lot of acting. And I went to lunch. And when I came back, it was gone.
Aww.
It Wonder who took it.
Sorry.
Many years ago. Anyway, the good news is, the fun part of the story is that about 3 years ago, I was at the Star Trek Vegas convention. And there was a guy there with all these props that he was selling. And I'm looking at these props from the original, from TOS. And there it was. The Brad Nelson phaser that I, the same one that I bought and had taken years ago. And my fiance bought it for me for my birthday. So I have another one now of the one that I lost when I was a little boy. You guys, I wish we had 3 hours. You're probably ready to get out of here.
Love you, Vic!
But I love you guys to death. Thank you.